Hi, everyone, and welcome to January 2020's Humanistic Management Professionals Lunch and Learn. I hope your year is going well so far. I'm Jennifer Hancock. I'm the founder of Humanist Learning Systems and a board member for the USA chapter of the International Humanistic Management Association. My co-host is Elizabeth.
Hi, everyone. Happy 2020. Elizabeth Castillo. I'm an assistant professor out here at Arizona State University. And thank you for joining us today.
And today, our guest, we're really excited, and he's excited, is Dan Tyre, an authority on inbound marketing and sales. He has become a regular speaker, blog writer, mentor, and coach for those who want to harness the power of inbound marketing to improve their bottom line. He joined Hubspot as a member of the original team in May of 2007 as their first salesperson. Since then, he's held various positions in sales, sales management, recruiting, training, and expansion of the Hubspot sales team. He's also created the term smarketing, which is the alignment of both sales and marketing. His favorite thing about sales is that it's about helping people, with the life motto of always be helping. His goal is to do the most good that he can for the universe. He loves helping local startups and serves as a mentor for executives and young people with heart and ambition, but a limited professional network. Dan is going to talk to us today about diversity, inclusion, and belonging, and how to actually do that, because HubSpot actually has a really good reputation for this. Y'all just won an award from Glassdoor. So let's talk about that, and let's have you start. You can start sharing your screen and start telling us how to replicate what you guys are doing.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jennifer. Thank you very much, Elizabeth. I should take you on the road with me, Jennifer. Super fun. All right, you're going to be my timekeeper, because I've got 176 slides and I got to go through them all very, very quickly.
I'll hold my ear for you.
Very good. Creating a culture of diversity, inclusion, and belonging. My name is Dan Tyre. I'm employee number 6 at HubSpot. And we're going to go through relatively quickly information about how our organization developed to take this very important concept and ensure that we could deliver it to our employees and to our customers. Can I start with a joke? Is this funny, Elizabeth? All right, put in the chat pane whether you think it's funny. I don't know. It was a mixed bag. Jennifer said it would go over very big in the Zoom. I was not so sure.
I love puns. That's good.
All right, good. How about this one? Mayan apocalypse. No? No way? I got to move on? Okay. Very, very good. We want to be playful here. Put in the Zoom group chat whether you think those are good jokes, and I'll either put it in the rotation or take it out. All right, my name is Dan Tyre. If you'd like, connect with me on LinkedIn, right? I have about 15,000 LinkedIn connections, and I'm happy to share my network with the people on this call. As Jennifer mentioned, I'm employee number 6 at HubSpot. I've been here 12 and a half years. I'm still a full-time executive at HubSpot. I started in sales. I invented the term schmarketing. Come off mute and say that, Jennifer. Schmarketing. Schmarketing. All right. You got to do it like you're from Brooklyn.
Marketing.
Right? There we go.
It's not an S marketing, and it's SCH marketing.
Yeah, exactly. That's the way you pronounce it. And it's a longer story than I have time for today, but it's now a accepted term of sales and marketing alignment. I've done 5 startups in the last 40 years. My first one went to $1.5 billion when $1 billion was real money. My second one, I was the CEO and founder of a company here in Boston and grew to $26 million, sold it to a Phoenix-based company where I now reside. My third startup went bankrupt, which taught me business planning and humility. My fourth startup got bought out by Microsoft. My fifth startup is HubSpot. HubSpot, put in the chat pane if you know HubSpot. It's currently traded on the New York Stock Exchange. We got 3,300 employees. HubSpot is sold in 132 countries. And it's a technology company that provides software to companies to help them grow better. I mentor about 35 folks. I'm an advisor to dozens of companies. I blog twice a month for the HubSpot sales blog. I'm a speaker. Last year, I spoke 54 times on behalf of HubSpot and 10 or 15 times on my own. I wrote a book called The Inbound Organization. I've invested in a few companies. I sit on 5 boards of directors. And as Jennifer said, my mission statement is to do the most good for the universe. So I met Elizabeth in an entrepreneurial program called Seed Spot, right in Phoenix. And she asked me to come and share a little bit of the tangible ways that HubSpot has created diversity, inclusion, and belonging. And put in the chat pane, please, if you're familiar with that term, inclusion, diversity, inclusion, and then belonging. Because I had never heard of the belonging part until Jabe Robles, our director of diversity, came to HubSpot and added the belonging. And it's a beautiful thing. And you'll see as I give you some tangible steps towards working towards that, how important that is. All right. I promised I would give 4 people a shout out. These are people who helped me prepare this presentation. I've asked each one of them to be as part of this presentation, and they couldn't fit into their schedule. But the first one is my friend and our chief people officer, Katie Burke. Right. And I've known Katie for 8 years. She's one of the most valuable employees at HubSpot. She's our chief people officer. And put in the chat pane if you're familiar with that term, chief people officer. I had never heard of it before. And it's the first tangible thing. If your organization doesn't have a chief people officer, you might want to take a look and understand why. Because she's the voice of the employee. And she's the person who always has our back. She now has a team of 10 people, I think maybe 15 people globally. And she is a powerful leader. She's MIT trained. She's super empathetic. She's unbelievably powerful on social media. She's a great person. And she was primarily responsible for helping us move to these the great things you're going to see today. The second lady is Megan Williams. And she works in human resources. She's responsible for all of our remote employees. And when I started HubSpot, I was the first remote employee in 2007. Now 10% of our workforce, over 300 people, work remote. And I'm gonna give you some specifics about what she does to make sure remote employees feel empowered. And she's awesome. She's a little shy, so she wouldn't come on, but she everything I talk about remote, like Megan has put in place. And then this is Melissa Obliata. She has been at HubSpot for 5 years. And she collaborated to launch all of our diversity programs. And she's passionate about diversity. She's strategic, she's realistic.
Can you speak into your microphone? You turned your head and we couldn't hear you.
Okay, got it. Thank you very much. She's just the best. Melissa has actually done all the things we're gonna talk about. She's always running programs. She's suggesting reading material. There's a book she wants us to read, and fast forward to 2019, diversity and inclusion is, you'll see, it's a big thing in HubSpot. And the last woman is Hannah Fleischman, and she wrote the book on inbound recruiting, which I have a slide. So I want to give all these ladies a shout out for helping me compile the content. All right, easy or hard, put in the Zoom group chat pane if it's easy or hard, unless you're driving. George, if you're driving, you don't have to do any of this. To be an advocate for diversity, inclusion, and belonging in 2019. And Jennifer, come off mute. We talked about this yesterday. What's your impression on easier or hard?
It's easy to say, hard to do.
Exactly, right? And so one of the things that we wanted to do is spend some time of giving you specific, tangible things that will be helpful. And I think more and more people are understanding how important this is. For us, for HubSpot, as a growth company, our culture is critically important. That's why we have a chief people officer. Because if you're able to attract the right employees, right, you have a huge competitive advantage, right? And so HubSpot is based in Cambridge, Massachusetts. We now have 8 offices across the world, have grown very, very quickly. As a tech company, we typically attract people who have certain values. But I'm going to show you, we've doubled down in making sure that people understand what it's like being a HubSpot employee. We provide software. All of our software starts at free, right? Which is a change that we've made in the last 3 years, because that's the way we help. And HubSpot is a leader in the inbound revolution. Oh, I wanted to mention, 3 weeks ago, We were voted the number one place to work by Glassdoor based on employees throughout the entire world. We're number one over Bain & Company, In-N-Out Burger. It's tough to like beat In-N-Out Burger. I know, Jennifer, you don't have In-N-Out Burger in Florida, but if you've ever had one, they're darn good. And DocuSign was number three. And so the takeaway from here is we take this very, very seriously, number one. Number two, we do what's called employee NPS. Are people on this call familiar with employee NPS, Net Promoter Score? Okay, so let me explain it. I see Elizabeth shaking her head. Employee NPS means 4 times a year, we go to all of our employees. We ask them 2 questions. Number one, rate your culture experience at HubSpot on a scale of 1 to 10. And there's a calculation that you do where you take your promoters, those are your 9s and 10s, you like block out the 6s, 7s, and 8s because they're middle of the road, and you subtract the detractors. Those are, I think, 1 through 5. And you come up with a calculation. And we do this 4 times a year, right? We some executives at HubSpot are paid based on their employee NPS, right? And we're fastidious. The senior management team reads every single employee comment. It's relatively quick. It's only 2 questions. The second question is, how likely are you to recommend HubSpot as a place to work? And then there's comment section. And in the last few years, we've broadened it a little bit so that we can get a little bit more feedback. But the idea is we're constantly querying our employees, not about what we do, but how we can improve and how it's perceived, right? Because like that's the reality that they, and it's not what we say, it's how they are perceived. So after 12 and a half years of really leading into culture, right, winning this award is public recognition for all the hard work that Katie Burke's team has done over that time. All right, so Jennifer asked me to just spend 30 seconds on what is inbound, and put in the chat lane if you know what inbound is. Inbound is a management philosophy of the way you engage for new customers or prospects or clients. And it starts with treating people like a human being, which sounds a little like crazy, but when you pick up the phone and cold call, or when you spam somebody, you're not treating them like a human being. The philosophy also says that you're going to help people before you sell to them. That's why we offer all of our software for free. And HubSpot has built this great brand and reputation because all we want to do is help. We do want you to buy software somewhere along the line when you're darn good and ready. Right? But the inbound revolution is all about personalized, customized information to help people grow better, right? And we are the leader in this whole inbound concept. It started with inbound marketing. Now we have inbound sales. We have inbound service. And in 2018, I wrote a book called The Inbound Organization that talks about the leadership principles as it relates. The most important part of inbound is that we like to help. And put in the Zoom group chat if you like to help. I know, Elizabeth. I know. It's somewhat of a rhetorical question. Most people, when I ask them, do you want a salesperson to call you up and help you or somebody to push you? They all say help. And so HubSpot has leaned into that for 12 and a half years with very good results. All right, how am I doing on time so far, Jennifer?
You're doing fine. And we just lost your audio for just a short second. But yeah, it's...
Am I back?
You're fine. You've got okay. About 4 or 5 more minutes.
Okay, I'm going to push through like 10 slides very quickly. These are the founders of HubSpot. My good friend, Brian Halligan, I've worked with for 20 years, and Dharmesh Shah, right? The takeaway from this is HubSpot is a dog-friendly company, right? We used to have unlimited dogs. Now you have to register your dog. We can only allow 6 dogs per floor, right? But one of the takeaways to have a diverse, inclusive, and belonging organization is allow dogs or pets. One of our customers is PetSmart. Right? PetSmart is awesome. You go in PetSmart, there's people with like birds on their shoulders and snakes on the table. And it's like super fun. They're a Phoenix-based company. But takeaway one is employee NPS. Takeaway two is dogs. Takeaway three is be a mission-driven organization. One of the qualifications that Glassdoor says is the people that rank very highly are mission-driven organizations. So at HubSpot, we have this thing called an M-Spot. And an M spot is one page that everybody in the company gets to see 7x24. It's posted on our wiki, right? That's part of what we call transparency. And transparency is super important, right, to being a diverse, inclusive, and belonging kind of company. This shows our mission. The HubSpot mission is to help millions of small businesses globally grow better. The serve, the S in MSpot, is who you serve. The plays are the 3 to 5 to 7 things that you do that you're going to serve that group and support your mission. The targets are how you're going to measure. And your missions, which is sometimes the most fun, is all the stuff you're not going to do this year. As I do my management consulting with universities and companies all over the world, I ask the top executives, do people know what the mission is? And then they always say, oh, sure, yes, they do. And then we ask the people in the organizations and they never know, right? Because it's hard to remember and they don't see it all the time. So the takeaway here is if you can put your mission, who you serve, your plays, your omissions, and your targets on one M spot, one page, right? And then you can post it with transparency so that anybody can comment or update. You have a better opportunity to make sure everybody in your organization understands your mission. The third thing, fourth thing, is that HubSpot has something called the culture code. And put it in the Zoom group chat if you know the HubSpot culture code. Right? This is something that our co-founder Dharmesh Shah did in 2012, and it's been seminal in helping us understand how to define a good, diverse, inclusive, and belonging culture. This is, it's 128 slides, Jennifer. And it's the most downloaded slide share in the history of slide share, 4 million times, right? And I have a slide on our culture code here. It's a way in which we describe the type of culture we're trying to recruit for and what we're looking for. And it is a very overt way of saying, this is what we stand for. If you stand for this, jump on the call. We also shorten it to an acronym called HEART. And HEART stands for humble, empathetic, adaptable, remarkable, and transparent. And Dharmesh has a second blog article that describes the culture code that also says the change in the culture code. Because we changed from effective to empathetic a few years ago to reflect how important diversity is to our culture. All right, the third thing, this is the fifth thing. Am I on the fifth thing? One of those things is that you've got to make sure that everybody knows, thank you, Jennifer, the fifth thing, is that everybody knows that you're actively seeking this diversity. So one of the things that Katie Burke did very early is that she started publishing our diversity statistics, right? And 5 years ago, we weren't that diverse. And this was a huge step in putting a stake in the ground. You can go back and see the 2017, 2018, 2019 diversity statistic. But what she said is, if you're not particularly good at it, you should post that because sunshine is the best medicine. I don't think that's exactly what she said, but something like that. If you're like transparent, then you can't run from it. And 4 years ago, only 25% of our managers, executives, and board directors were women, right? The next year was 38%. The next year was 47%, right? And now the diversity report has ethnic diversity, gender diversity, age diversity, all of these different ways that we can benchmark to make sure that we're constantly improving. So the next takeaway is to make sure, this is hard for a lot of people, but even if you're not that diverse, to post those statistics as a way to benchmark. My friend Hannah Fleischman is responsible for recruiting the folks into HubSpot. And what she discovered 5 years ago is you just can't put an ad on Indeed and expect to get top employees to come. So inbound recruiting is all about establishing an employee or associate profile or persona. And what that will do is help you identify the best way to go after the best employees, right? And today, you know, there's virtually 0% unemployment in the United States. You have to start early. So we start recruiting employees even in high school with the brand awareness to talk about all the ways that you can come to HubSpot and do your best work. Oh, Jennifer wanted me to mention this. This is the pretty cool company, right? We have noticed that sometimes when people are growing families, both men and women, they feel like they're a little out of touch. They may not have been in the workforce. They may have been great workforce workers.
Your voice is muffled again? I don't know if there's something with the mic that's getting covered or...
Maybe... Okay. How's that? Is that better?
Better.
Okay, thank you very much. The Returners Program allows somebody to come into HubSpot who hasn't worked in the workforce for 20 years. You can download this, or Elizabeth will send you the link, and you work for 20 hours. You get your groove back. You understand what's going on. And at the end of a period, if you want to continue to work for 20 hours and you've shown that you can add value through the process, you re-up for another 20 hours. Many times we'll move people into a full-time position because they're ready to come back to enter. All right, if you want more information, this is a book that I wrote called The Inbound Organization. It talks about how to create all of these programs to do it. How did I do in my 5 minutes, Jennifer?
Perfect. We are now at 12:20, so you did awesome.
Do you want me to talk about the free gifts or keep those hidden?
Yeah, why don't you talk about the free gifts, because I think Elizabeth has already posted the links in the chat room. And for everybody else that's watching this, on our website, we'll have a blog post that includes all of these links. So,
all right, put in the Zoom group chat, unless you're driving, if you like free gifts. Right? This is the inbound process, right? Most people like smile, just like Elizabeth did. Yes, I like free stuff. We have all the reasons why you like free stuff, right? But if it's a value, we want to help. So the first is how to define inspiring mission and vision statement. Oh, when I was talking about my book, I forgot to tell you that on this website, inboundorganization.com, there's tons of free stuff. And if you're going to build your M spot and you need help, Todd, who's my co-author, and I will cycle in. You just submit it, and we'll help you. Sometimes it takes a little time to build your M spot because you got to get everybody on board. And there are tons of free resources. There's an assessment. Lots of people ask me, okay, but no one in my group is like on board with this. How do I get everybody else on board? So you take an assessment, 56 questions. It takes you 10 minutes. And then you get a score. And then we can make specific recommendations on how you can go ahead and get everybody else on board. All right, if you just need to define an inspiring mission and vision statement, this is a free guide. This is courtesy of HubSpot. And has anybody ever heard of HubSpot Academy? Right, this is very interesting. In keeping with the inbound philosophy, we offer 84 hours and 16 certifications in all digital realms for free. Right? And people just go to HubSpot Academy, you sign up, you take these online classes, you go as quickly as or slowly as you want. And the goal is at the end, right, you'll have a certification that many times will ensure that you're guaranteed employment, right? There's some in marketing, there's some in sales, there's some in operations, business ops, sales management, all the inbound disciplines designed to help you build your confidence and credibility. Oh, and then my friend Megan Williams, published this remote work report in 2019. And put in the Zoom group chat if your organization leans into remote or not. Yes, remote, no remote. And what do you think, Jennifer? Of this group, do you think there's a lot of folks who are open to working remote?
I think everybody's open to remote working, and I think it's the key to helping. You mentioned the helping people return to work. You know, as a mom, I know a lot of other moms who are always looking for work, but they're kind of constrained by the fact that they're the primary caregiver. So remote, flexible work of 20 hours a week, man, there's a ton of really qualified, intelligent women out there and men who are parents, you know, that would love to be contributing to society in some way and bringing in some extra income, but they can't necessarily get to an office. So,
yeah, exactly. I was talking to a woman that I mentor, right? On the last slide, here, I have a mentorship program where I mentor about 35 people, both women, people of color, CEOs of up to $30 million companies. And she works for a major technology company. And before she went on maternity leave, she negotiated the ability to work from home 1 day a week. But then she wanted to move it to 2 days a week. And they said, no. And she's like, I have to drop my kid off. I don't, like, I can't live an hour away, work an hour away. And so she's considering other employment because people aren't flexible on that, like, remote work. And so this is 2020, right? This is a real thing. And I know sometimes people think that if you come into the office, you're more productive. Having been a remote employee for 12 and a half years, Jennifer, right? That's not true, right? I work from home all the time. I save 90 minutes commute each way, right?
I can, like, multitask. I can be part of my wife's life. I can see my kids.
Awesome. So you get actually better productivity.
Megan, oh, sure. You know, people that go into the office, a lot of the time they're sitting there not working, right?
Yes. Yeah, and they chit-chat, right? I get a lot of stuff done because no one bothers me, right? And I know that's part of the culture and, like, it's important. This lady, Megan, started a remote water cooler. And so everybody who's remote, now there's 300 people, they show up once a week with their dogs and with their cats and talk about some, like 2 weeks ago, I was at the remote water cooler. The Star Wars movie was coming out. There were like 15 people who were dressed like Obi-Wan Kenobi and the, what's the hairy guy from Star Wars? Put in the chat pane if you know the big hairy guy from Star Wars.
Oh, Chewie.
Chewbacca, that's it. Like, you can't do that at work. You can't walk in dressed like a hairy guy from Star Wars, but everybody in remote, they're like, they're all in. And so it was a great reminder. We also have this thing called the remote donut. So once a month, you get a Slack message that says, all right, Dan, you should talk with Elizabeth Castillo. And it has her contact information. Jump on her calendar. And I'm like, we just chat. And so I know all these people remotely that I've never met before. In fact, I'm sharing a desk in Cambridge this week with this lady, Selena Gutierrez, who's in San Antonio, right? And I met her over the remote donut. And, like, we talked for, like, half an hour, so it feels like we're connected, which is, like, ultimately what you want to do for your
remote. That's a big part of feeling like you belong, right? It's not enough. We talked about this the other day. It's not enough to recruit in diversity, you know, people of with whatever diversity metric you want to use, if they don't feel like they belong.
Yes, that's right. Jaime Robles. It used to be D&I, diversity and inclusion, and he's like, no, you don't get it. It actually, he would never be that forceful. He would be soft spoken. He would be very accommodating, and he would say, diversity and inclusion is important. But we want everybody to belong because we want to be the organization and culture where people can do their best work. And so thank you for reminding me. The way HubSpot works through belonging is we have employee resource groups. There's one for people of color at HubSpot, or POCA, where executives can take a young African-American or a Native American and work with them to ensure they have a highly successful career at HubSpot, right? You meet on a regular basis, sometimes weekly, sometimes monthly. You're available to them. It's unbelievably impactful because you understand what it's like to be maybe the first African-American in your group, or the first Muslim American, right? Woman of color in a sales organization. And I've had both of those scenarios with just great people that have enlightened me and helped me understand, right? What it's really like to come in as a minority into a tech company. Then we have one for parents. Because at HubSpot, everybody works 60 hours a week. It's a tech company, so they're like crazy hard work. And then when you have kids, you can't go into the office like as much as you can't work as much as you used to. So the employee resource group for a parent spot, they call it, right, helps you understand and make that transition. And then we have LGBT plus, right, where we want people of all diverse, like, backgrounds and activities to feel comfortable coming to HubSpot, that number one, we're going to be very accommodating to whatever they feel like they're going to describe themselves as. Number two, that we're going to teach people that they have to be open to different perspectives. So everybody goes through training, and all of the managers go through training on how to look at it, right? And then there's one other employee research. I think it's remote workers, right? So then everybody gets together. And I'm sure there'll be more in the future, but these employee resource groups are great ways for folks to identify and come together and work together to make sure that they feel like they're all on the same page.
And I would imagine too that the mentorships that get established through the resource groups also help people feel like they have allies, so that if they do have a problem or something happens, they have someone they can talk to that's not necessarily HR, but someone that they trust because the relationship was built so that they...
Super smart.
Yeah.
Yes, there's a blog article I think I sent to Elizabeth about allyship, which I had never heard, and it's a verb. And HubSpot has all the research that inclusive companies have like 2.5 times higher cash flow per employee. They're almost twice as likely to be innovative. And allyship is this thing where people with like privilege and power understand empathy for people who may have they're minorities or could be marginalized groups, right? And the goal is to create this culture where everybody feels valued, supported, and heard. And it's not like they talk about it all the time. It's a verb, right? And you'll be talking around and somebody will, let's say a joke that's not, it could be slightly offensive, right? As an ally, you're like, hold on a second, come over here. Right? And when the senior executives are professional and take somebody aside, like, can you understand how that might impact a 24-year-old woman when she's hearing something like that? All of a sudden, it completely changes the game, right? And when on the HubSpot M spot, diversity, inclusion, belonging is one of the things that is important that we track all the time, right? And so there's tons of effort and focus and ideas that like everybody has to certainly lean in to make sure that we get it right.
So one of the things you and I talked about yesterday was the why, right? Why should companies take this seriously? And I think we talked about how do you even solve problems effectively if you don't have diversity?
Yeah, well, the statistics, if anybody needs the statistics, let me know, because I'll send them to you. Right, there's study after study that says diverse cultures have a huge competitive advantage. Right, for me, if you got like one type of person is solving problems, you don't really have the diversity of opinions that's required to deal in like 2020. Right, the second thing is I'm super proud. HubSpot is one of 15% of companies traded on the New York Stock Exchange, 3 women on our board of directors. A person of color on our board of directors. If you want to sell to women, you better have women making the decision. We have this conference called the Inbound Conference every year, and it's amazing. 25,000 people show up in Boston, and it's at the Seaport, and we have world-class speakers, very, very diverse. But I'm overhearing these young women talking about the speakers on stage and the executives at HubSpot, and they're like, no. At HubSpot, the women make the decision, and that is exactly right. Lori Norrington, who's on our board of directors, brilliant, right? And the people that we recruit understand that as a competitive advantage. And then you had a suggestion, if you're not working for a cultural diverse organization, what would you do, Jennifer?
Well, I'd probably leave.
Right. Okay, so we were laughing about that yesterday because Jennifer's kind of a hard ass when it comes to that, but it's because it's a little bit funny, but it's not that funny because that's what people are going to do.
Yeah.
Right. We're going to be, because we spent 12 years building this culture, we get the best and the brightest. Oh, let me tell you about my boss, Katie Ang Mack. She runs the global partner program. I actually hired her and now I report to her, which is fantastic. Right. She was promoted on maternity leave. Have you ever heard of that, where somebody was promoted while she was out having a baby? She was, my buddy Pete Caputa promoted her on maternity. I love telling that story because she was the right person for the job. She wasn't forgotten. Pete said, okay, I know you're having a baby, but like when you're coming back, we want you to take a management position, right? And that embodies
the boldness, and this is a 2020 company that really wants to walk the walk and do the right thing so that we can be reflective of the kind of people we're going to sell to. If you're going to sell to women, you better have women in the decision-making positions. And HubSpot does that.
So I've got one last question before we open it up to the discussion board, because I know there's a lot of questions and comments that have come in through the chat room. The last thing we talked about that I think is really, really important is what happens if you have, and when we talk about Glassdoor, all these companies have great cultures, but people don't like their mid-level manager. So,
You know, Jennifer, excuse me for interrupt. Go ahead.
No, so the question is, how does HubSpot handle the lack of buy-in from an individual that could kill the entire culture initiative?
Oh yeah. This is Katie Burke. Right. And in the beginning, right, not everybody understood. It wasn't that they didn't understand, but the behavior had to catch up to the mindset. Right. So there are a lot of times when people would make mistake. We call it using poor judgment. Right. And she would like take them aside. She would explain a little bit about what they just did. She would always ask, how do you think that would make a 22-year-old woman of color feel? And you could see it on the person's face. I observed dozens of those meetings where the executive's like, oh my gosh, I didn't even think about that. And that's kind of the point. The next thing she did is she recruited this guy, Andrew Quinn, who's been around for 10 years. Andrew had a program. He's a full-time employee. He had a program where if employees felt like their manager wasn't on board with all of the diversity and inclusion kind of things, they would send an email to Andrew, and Andrew would work with an extended period of time with that executive to make sure that they understood from one executive to the next that they weren't being perceived by the employees or their group in line with one of our core like values. Right. And Andrew had dozens, probably hundreds of very difficult conversations with people where it wasn't natural for them to understand why this is one of the most important components of the foundations of the company. But after you do that for 4 years, after you make sure all of your managers, your directors, your VPs go through a certain training, now we have allyship like vocabulary. Now everybody goes through this kind of thing in the onboarding. Now it's permeated through the culture. Now it's so much easier because we have the economies of scale and more people understand that this is the way we want to run our company. And it's reflective in the culture code. So if you're not on board with this culture, don't come work here. Because believe me, right? HubSpot's harder to get into than Harvard or MIT. We take 140 resumes to get down to one employee. The best part of HubSpot is the people, and really smart people who get competitive advantage want to work in a diverse, inclusive, and belonging environment.
So what happens if the coaching of the individual fails?
That's happened. It's happened.
And what do you
say? Well, people have been terminated for lack of good judgment, right? There's a human resource issue. You want to make an example so that people understand, but you also want to be empathetic. And if somebody didn't do the right thing, you can't always tell people why. But in the tribal knowledge of the organization, people know that people have been terminated from employment because they haven't used good judgment in supporting our culture code. Right. Okay. And so it's like a real thing. Right. And I think that it's one of the most outstanding things. Our management is very forward-thinking, all right? Our co-founder is Indian national, right? We've worked very, very hard over an extended period of time. And it was tough in the early days, right? It's still tough. You're still like changing hearts and minds in a very challenging political and like global environment, right? But when you see, I got the reason why it's I know I'm on the winning side is I have the data and the facts. There's science that supports that if you move into this direction, right, you're going to be a better company. You're going to recruit better employees. You're going to have a huge competitive advantage. And once you can prove that, smart people will typically gravitate towards that that direction.
Perfect. Elizabeth, do you want to start asking or going through the chat room? And Dan, can you stop sharing the screen so we can see you in your full glory?
Great. Thank you. So we've got a few things in the chat room. So I'm going to go ahead and open it up to people who have asked. And if you've put it something in the chat, I may be unmuting you. I'm going to start with Dr. S. Atia Martin. They've asked a couple of questions. Dr. Martin, are you there?
I am here.
Oh, okay. Do you want to, I know you asked something about the ERGs and then about the, another question about conflict management, right?
Yes. So the first part was really about how ERGs are leveraged at HubSpot beyond coaching people up. So in other words, those are diverse voices that generally have a different experience and reality within organizations, regardless sometimes of how amazing the organization is. What are the ways that the ERGs connect to decision making, whether it's the cultural survey or any other decision points that can help reveal some of the challenges that underestimated groups are experiencing that are unique, as well as the aligning with the fact that usually those experiences are also representative of systemic structural challenges that other people who don't fall into those groups are experiencing too. It's just worse for them. So how is that pool of data tapped into in order to support decision making?
So a good question. For each one of the ERGs, there's an executive sponsor. Right, and it's somebody who sits in our senior management team that is going to be the person that can help when that inevitable information flows up. Number two, each ERG has a budget, right? And it's good when you have a budget because then you can do programs and develop like events that they're open to everybody, that people can go through and learn a little bit more, right? The parent ERG is very interesting because there's probably a certain percentage of people who aren't even parents but are thinking about being parents and are thinking about how this may apply to them. So an executive sponsor for each ERG. I think Melissa is the person who decides if new ERGs need to be created or funded, right? They're periodically evaluating new ERGs to meet the needs of our global workforce, right? And then the executive sponsors usually take an active role. And I know in the person of color at HubSpot, or what we call POCA, I've been active for the last 3 years. And I've learned a ton. It has been instrumental to my entire business career to understand what a 22-year-old African-American woman would feel like coming into our sales floor. That has helped change my thought process that has impacted the entire HubSpot sales process. Did that answer your question?
So I think she's muted now.
I just unmuted myself. Sorry about that. Partially, but for time's sake, I will not hog up the airtime as there are a number of people on. There's a follow-up question I had that actually someone else asked too, which is really about how conflict management is managed in the context of DEI, considering that when you bring diverse people together, conflict inevitably happens, but it can be healthy conflict if people are given the right tools. And the organization takes the root causes seriously. So there's more in how that, if there's a process for that and how it works.
It's a great question. And the conflict, so first of all, we teach all our managers, directors, executives that here's the baseline of what you should be looking for. We also, with the allyship program, make sure that you're overhearing kind of things. You're right, the conflict is inevitable. right? The most important thing is we don't want to jump to conclusions. We want to be very good active listeners, right? And as part of having a chief people officer with a team of folks, if anybody at HubSpot feels like, number one, they're not being heard, or their immediate manager isn't understanding what they're trying to say, there is a way for you to escalate that through people ops, so that if it's a senior manager, if it's a VP, right, you can have my buddy Andrew Quinn will go over and evaluate that particular situation, sometimes over a period of time, to improve that individual way they perform, and also to identify the particular issue and make sure that it doesn't fest. And if you have additional follow-up, just send me an email, dtyre@hubspot.com, and I'm happy to give you more detail.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much. The next person who asked a question was Judith Weisinger, so I've unmuted her, wanting to know, what type of training do employees go through with respect to diversity, inclusion, and belonging? Judith, are you there?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Yeah. What, you want to talk to Dan?
Yeah, Dan, thanks very much. I actually study research. I'm a professor and a research in this area. And one of the things that my colleagues and I are always looking at is, how do organizations, quote unquote, train people into this culture? So you've delineated this culture code. You've talked to us about the employee resource groups, about having Andrew kind of be there to coach through problems. But when people come into the organization, is there kind of a baseline process for onboarding them, to introduce them to these aspects of your culture? And if so, is it ongoing? You know, how long does it take? Just kind of interested in the nitty-gritties from the standpoint of somebody first coming into the organization.
Yeah. So first of all HubSpot employees, when they sign on, remote folks as well as people in one of our 8 offices, go through 30 days of training. As part of that training, they see the HubSpot M-Spot, which are the most important components of what we're going to accomplish every year. And starting in 2019, diversity, inclusion, and belonging was on the M-Spot. Right. So those are the 5 areas that are most important to HubSpot. So they see it. It's like very overt. Number 2, we have a culture code. The culture code includes empathetic. And so when we go through the culture code and why it's important to have a culture code, there's a huge discussion around what it means to be empathetic. There's a whole series of training that people take about what it means to be empathetic to people that you may not be familiar with, and what it might like be if you're the only Native American in a group, right? Or if you're the only parent in a group, or if you're the remote person who's in San Diego with a group of everybody who's in Dublin. And then on our manager offsites, twice a year, right, there is always some emphasis on real life examples, either a role play or a world-class speaker who will come in and talk about like the new information and new challenges that people face. And in those situations, people will submit like real life managerial like issues that they've had. Everybody at HubSpot has to go through Learn at HubSpot, it's a 30-minute recording about diversity and inclusion. And then we talk about everybody has to go through a empathetic training, right? And I think they run that every 2 years, just as a reminder that this is super important. So there, everybody gets it at the beginning when they first come on, multiple times. Every, as a manager, director, or VP, everybody is reminded twice a year. It is on the M-Spot, so you can't be more obvious than that. And then as chief people officer, I will say Katie Burke spends a lot of time reminding people that our culture is our most important attribute, and that diversity, inclusion, and belonging is the foundation of our culture.
Great, thank you.
Elizabeth, I just wanna do the kind of housekeeping because we've got about 10 minutes left.
Okay.
This program was approved for HRCI and SHRM recertification credits. My company, Humanist Learning System, will issue certificates of completion for people who participated in this program. What we need from you is to put your name, your email, and which certificates you want. You can get more than one, HRCI, SHRM, or General Certification of Completion. The name, but I do need the name and the email to send it to you. And just put that in the chat. Elizabeth?
Great. And thank you so much, Jennifer. Next, I think we'll hear from Dr. Marty Schumacher, who had a couple of questions, one regarding employees with negative feedback. Marty, are you there?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Can.
Okay. Yeah, I really appreciate Dan's enthusiasm. Having consulted with a number of small businesses here in Western Canada for about 40 years, what he's describing is, you know, some of the great humanistic values that have always I've tried to integrate in my practice. However, the size of his company, and it sounds like the kind of revenue they generate, has allowed them to have a lot of time available for these kind of enrichment and diversity training and bringing people on. In Canada, 95% of the businesses make under $5 million a year. And so they don't have a lot of excess time and personnel to implement some of these things. I think things like culture codes and some of the ways you hire and other ways are insightful and can replace more antiquated methods. For example, one of the things that I did a lot of conflict management training, and that in young companies in which employees have to perform at pretty high levels to keep the company afloat, there's invariably conflict over their job reviews because of the need to produce revenue and make their time well worth it. They don't all have training in how to give positive job reviews. And so I'm wondering, in your system, how do you have a structured job review process that can allow for empathy and exchange? And how do you have conflict? Because most employees don't want to be told anything bad about what they do, you know, unless they're extremely enlightened and secure. So I'm wondering, how do you structure your job reviews so that you can handle the criticism that invariably people need to grow and get better?
All right, there's like three great questions in there, and I'm gonna take them like from a reverse order. So number one, we do employee reviews. Number two, we lean into the criticism, right? We prefer the criticism because as a great company, we know the stuff that we do good. What we really need to do is how we can constantly improve. So managers, directors, VPs are paid in certain instances based on that employee NPS, which is completely, it's anonymous, right? But if you don't perform on your employee NPS, that means you've lost the hearts and minds of the people in your group. That means you're not going to be effective. That means as a senior executive, you got to take that manager out because it doesn't work anymore. All HubSpotters have one-on-ones with their manager at least once every 2 weeks. Right. So they're getting feedback every single week, right? Or every other week that, yes, they're meeting expectations, not meeting expectations, or exceeding expectations. Once a year, we do a formal employee review, but the employee review isn't like the one time you talk about your performance. It includes 360 reviews. So other people, right, get to weigh in on the value that you have, what we call enterprise value for the organization. Right. So there is the NPS survey. There is biweekly one-on-ones. There is annual reviews. And all of that serves for good managers at HubSpot to constantly be looking at that, like criticism, to understand how they can be better managers. In addition, we nominate 8 to 10 manager of the year, which is a very highly desired credential in HubSpot. So people are vying to try to make sure that they're viewed by their folks as strong leaders that always have their back, right? And that has been a great way to do it. By the way, a lot of the things, and you've mentioned a couple of them, you don't have to spend a lot of money, right? HubSpot does have high margin products that allows us the luxury of doing a lot of those things. But back in when we started the program, we had no money. And a lot of those things that you mentioned, you can do, and it's worthwhile doing it because this is the future of business, right? When people say, this seems like a lot, I'm like, no, this seems like this is exactly what you want to do if you want to attract the best and brightest. And it's hard, right? And this change will take, I don't know, you guys are the experts. I bet you it'll take 100 years, multiple generations, right? But the people on this call understand that this is the most valuable thing that you can do to attract. If you don't have happy employees, you're never going to have happy customers, right? Frank Osher, who's our CIO, a white 50-year-old man, he is the executive sponsor of the People of Color at HubSpot, along with Andrew Lindsay, an African-American leader of our venture capital fund. And he says, if you don't have happy employees, you're not going to have happy customers. So we have to lean into these kind of things. And even if you don't have any money, you have to like find ways that your employees can be heard.
I'd like to follow up on that real quick. Just the thing that's striking me the most out of everything you've given us, yeah, I've taken notes. I have like 7 different tangible things we can do, but the idea of tying manager pay to employee happiness has got to be the most radical thing I think you've said.
So, really?
Yeah, I know. It's brilliant, and it ensures that the manager is a mentor and, you know, a supporter of the employees as opposed to being kind of a dictatorial manager. And maybe it's because of my background, I deal with workplace bullying, so I get called in when companies have problems, right? But creating a culture where it's understood that the manager's job is to assist the employees, and if they're assisted, they'll be happy, and that's what you're getting paid for, is to me just brilliant. So
okay, so everybody, these employee NPS surveys are scrutinized, right? Our senior executives read every single comment, right? They know all the good stuff, right? And HubSpot's been a highly successful company. They obsess over the stuff that, like, people will say that they haven't heard before, right? And we judge our NPS, our employee NPS. We agonize over it, right? And all these changes, many of these great ideas have come from people who say, why don't we have employee resources group? Why don't we hire more remote people? And so what happens when you recruit forward-thinking, great, diverse, inclusive, and belonging employees, right? They teach you how to walk the walk. And it's great. I love working for HubSpot because this is the kind of company I want to work for, that are not only changing it for our culture, but we want you to take all these great ideas, right? We want you to understand how HubSpot has done it so that you can go out and do it in your own company. We want our illustrious alumni. That's the other thing. When you graduate from HubSpot, for the first 4 startups that I did, if you quit, I hated you. I'm like, you quit my company. Now, if you leave HubSpot, you're an illustrious alumni. We like love you. We have meetings where you come back because we know that the real vision of HubSpot is not just to sell software, not just to help people, but we want to make sure that we're doing everything that we can to honor like our people who helped us grow our great company.
We've got 2 minutes before the end. Dan, do you want to leave us with any parting words? And everybody else, if you need a certificate, make sure you put it in the thing. We're going to send out an email with all the links and a copy of the video as well. But Dan, do you have any last things you want us to take away from this?
I think when HubSpot made diversity, inclusion, and belonging one of the core components of our culture was one of the happiest days of my life. Right? I like to do good things for the universe. That's just not a mission statement. This is vital kind of stuff. And you guys are on the front lines of trying to change like the way we've thought about business for the last 50 years. And this is kind of radical and it's definitely hard. I never underestimate what it's like to be the one person who understands D, I, and B in a group of people who don't. That was Katie Burke 8 years ago, but it can be done and you can follow the playbook and we are all in. You email me dtyre@hubspot.com. I get a lot of emails, but I'll get back and you talk with Elizabeth or Jennifer And anything that we can do to help you, like, bring this mindset to more businesses in Western Calgary, in Dublin, Ireland, in Madrid, Spain, we're all in. That's the inbound philosophy. And thank you very much for your time today, and look forward to helping you build your cultures in 2020.
Thank you, Dan. Just want to remind everybody, this was the International Humanistic Management Association's Humanistic Management Professionals Lunch and Learn. We do this just about every month. Our next one is going to be on February 24th. We have not yet posted it on Eventbrite, but that's the date, so save it. Elizabeth, any closing words?
Sorry, I was typing to get everybody's certificate. So just be sure to include your email, please. No, thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to seeing you next month and really appreciate you taking the time to be with us today.